together. Let's start out with that song, Bless That Wonderful Name of Jesus. Are you ready? Come on. Christian Fellowship, and if this is your very first time, we're just excited and pleased and happy in the Lord to have you here. If you're not familiar with Set Free, we're just a down-home, regular old Bible preaching, fun-loving, happy, family-oriented, down-to-earth, low-riding, biker-running, soul-winning, devil-hating. Our school colors are black here, if you wonder why. It's my favorite color. We just love Jesus, and we're good to have you here. And it's a real blessing, and God is just doing some neat things in our community. And we love our neighbors, we love our friends, and God's given us a real love for people. And we're just seeing families being brought together and lives changed. So I just thank all of you that are part of the Set Free family, and all of your prayers are working. I'm getting sweeter every day. If you've been praying for me to get sweeter, it's happening. The spirit of sweetness has been coming upon me quite a bit lately. And my wife never thought that would happen, but it's happening. So praise the Lord. You can see our little TBN camera crew is finishing a little Set Free documentary this week. So they'll be doing some filming. So when the camera comes your way, just act natural. If you're a sourpuss, let us capture that, okay? We want everybody to know we work with sourpusses too. It's all right. That's how people begin. But let's sing Hosanna to the Lord now. Lord, deliver us, minister to us right now. Hosanna. Let's lift up the name of Jesus here. Let's let the power of God touch every heart in this place, okay? That sound fair enough? Let's let God minister. Thank you. Let's join hands with that person next to you. After we're done having a word of prayer, we'll give you an opportunity to meet all those people that are around you. I'm just so excited, Carl. It's so neat to have you here, man. I tell you, I love having our neighborhood be able to come in and see what the Lord's doing here. And all the different kind of rascals that come to set free. It looks like we ran out of chairs again. And, we've been doing that a lot lately. But you guys got to make up your mind where you're going to go to church. And we'll buy some more chairs, but we don't want to buy for church hoppers. We want people that want to belong to a church. Amen? And plus, I'm not saying that about anybody coming. It's good to come early. You know that Bible verse, the early bird catches the worm? You all know that's the book of Phil. But if you people that are standing up, I promise you'll come back next Sunday. We'll buy some more chairs, okay? Would you like to come back next Sunday? Raise your hands back to those of you who don't have a chair. Raise your hands if you'd like us to get you a chair for next Sunday. Okay? All right. Let me put on my glasses so I can see who's here. Ah, Mickey. All right. Good to see you. This dear lady, I tell you, she ministered to me when I was locked up, and not too many people would visit me. I thank God for you, sis. I thank God. I'll tell you, when you're down, you find out who really cares. And as Christian brothers and sisters, I want you to know, we want to be a group of people that's set free, that don't give up on anybody. Because Jesus never gave up on us, and he doesn't. He loves us with a never-ending love. And one of the great things that he tells his people, the church, over and over is don't quit. Don't quit. Don't give up on anybody. Don't give up on your mother. Don't give up on your wife. Don't give up on your husband. Don't give up on your daughter. Don't give up on your son. Don't give up on your pastor. Don't give up on the band. Don't give up on the greeters if they don't give you a good greeting that you'd like to receive. You know, some people get upset. Gee, he hugged me last week. This week, just a high five. Must be backslidden. You know, pray for those greeters. Everybody went to the bathroom already and all that kind of stuff. You got that taken care of? We want to take care of business for God now. Amen? Let's join our hearts together and let's just pray and talk to God together. Heavenly Father, we come to you in the precious name of Jesus. And Jesus, we ask right now that your presence would be experienced here this morning to set free. Lord, visit us today in an extraordinary way, I pray, God. Let it begin with my heart, God. May I not speak one word that isn't from above. May I not say one thing, Lord, that isn't directed by you, Lord. Help me to be a blessing to your people here today, Lord. As we sing to you, Lord, God, may we just lift up that sweet and precious and holy name of Jesus, Lord. May the Holy Spirit's power be a healing salve to touch people that are in physical need today, Lord. God, someone's mind today who is troubled, God, give them peace right now, Lord. Bring joy into their life, Lord. Restore families together, parents with their children, Lord. God, give a new zeal and excitement about living for you, Lord. Show us a big ray of hope today, Lord, I pray, as we live in this dark and dreary world. God, as there seems to be so many things happening all over this world, in the name of Jesus, Lord, show us what it all means. Help us to put it all together, God, so we can see our purpose in this big world. God, help us to find your perfect will in our lives today, God. And if there be one here today, Lord, that doesn't know you as Savior, I pray that today would be the day they give their lives to you. And God, we know these prayers are going to be answered, and it's going to be an awesome service, and you're going to do wonderful things in people's lives today, because Jesus, you are, Lord, and you're in charge of everything, and we thank you for answering our prayers. In your precious name we pray, amen. Before you're seated, hug about 15, 20 people, okay? Let me have the Set Free rappers up here. You Set Free team. Get it ready. Don't play it.
Thank you.
too friendly. All right. Okay. Well, as soon as Lois is ready, we'll be getting ready here. Okay. Right now, I want you to know we ordered another 1,000 of the Set Free Posse wrap tape to give out to everybody. So we'll be giving more of those out today. And as our custom is here at Set Free, and as the way the Lord has directed us, everything here is always free, okay? Set free. Freely we have received, freely we shall give. My son just finished the latest rap tape they made, and it talks about Jesus. Let me play you a little quick cut on the first song, Give God the Glory. Put that on. I want you to hear a little bit with the quality of this next one.
This party's filled with God's love. No drugs, no booze, and no sex. This party's filled with respect for God, cause he's the righteous one, Lord of Lords, God's only son. King of kings, hallelujah. Listen now, the Spirit talks to you. Loud and clear, God's near. Word of God is what you're gonna hear from me, Brother G. Homeboys on the road to live and set free. It's time to give you the story. Check it out, it's God the Lord. Gave his life on a cross. When he died, it was no loss, cause he lives in me. Jesus Christ is a runner, so he broke the chains. I was bound. Place my feet up on a high ground. Let it flow. Now I know that heaven's where I'm going to go. And we knew he'd be true. Not only our souls, but he wants us to. Here it is, the whole truth. Serve God when you got your view. Check it out, what he's done. Give the glory to his only son.
For free to everybody, and you can bless your friends and your neighbors and everybody and let them know that, you know, there's some Christians that are on fire and happy to be singing and serving Jesus Christ. The Bible says, singing to yourself in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, making melody in your heart unto the Lord. And some folks misinterpreted that in the Greek and thought it meant boring music. But in the original translation, it means songs that praise and lift up God. It means music that has a beat. That's why God gave us every kind of instrument. And it meant something that had life would get you excited about living for Jesus Christ. And that has all of the above and those songs. Praise God. Let me remind you to be in prayer. All of our outreaches, we always invite everybody to go with us every week. Almost we're on the road going places, ministering at churches, jails, prisons. And this month coming up, we're going to the Ventura Ladies Jail. We're going to do in Lake Elsinore next week on Friday and Saturday night. Our Set Free Posse is going to Lakeland Christian Center. Next week, and we'll also be at Crossroads Community Church doing outreach. We'll be doing Assembly of God in Compton, another Assembly of God church in L.A. Week after that, Calvary Church in Anaheim, Calvary Chapel in Anaheim. And then we'll be going in March to Central Juvenile Hall and doing a concert over there. And then we'll be going to Big Bear the next week after that. And then we'll be going to Palm Springs for 2 days to work with Mario Murillo and some other prophet fellow over there. And we give God the glory that we can go out and serve Him. Last night we had a rap concert here, and a ton of kids gave their lives to Jesus Christ. Amen. The week before that, we had a lowrider, Oldie But Goodies night, where a bunch of lowriders and Oldie But Goodies gave their life to Jesus Christ. The week before that, we had skaters, we had ramps all over this place and skateboards flying all over. And then we gave an altar call, and hundreds of skateboarders gave their life to Jesus Christ. And the Bible says, become all things to all people that you might win them to Christ. That's what it's all about. It don't matter what costume you wear. You might have the conservative costume and think you're conservative. I know inside you need Jesus just like everybody else. You might think you've got a radical costume on, you know. You ever see, it's kind of like a little kid, my little boy Hebrew. I can remember him about 3 years old, and he got a first pair of cowboy boots. And he just thought he was cool. He put his little bony legs in there, wore these little shorts, you know, no shirt on, a little cowboy hat, go walking outside. And that God looks at us as little children. He sees we put on a surf costume. Yeah, I'm a surfer, dude. Right. Yeah, I'm a lowrider, man. You know what? I'm a biker. I'm a biker guy. Or, you know, I'm a dweeb. You know who you are. I'm not pointing out people today. I'm not going to do that. Don't try to get me to point anybody out today. Let me see if I have any other special announcements. I'm going to... That's great. Everybody still likes me, right? Nobody's mad at me yet this morning? I'm going to try my best not to get anybody mad at me today. I take that back. Just a few of you. Those who really need it, okay? Today we're going to hear from God. We're going to hear some testimonies. And hear some music. And all of it, like it says, is for the purpose of lifting up Jesus. The Bible says that we've lifted up Jesus, other people will be drawn to Him. It's not about a certain church, a certain denomination, or anybody or anything else. It's anything that's good to any of us. It's Jesus. The Bible says in our flesh dwelleth no good thing. And God knows what He's talking about. You and I are worthless, no good creatures without Jesus. But when we have Jesus living inside of us, man, a whole new change takes place. A whole new creation begins, a new life starts coming in. And we are blessed, I'm telling you, in this garage church over here at Set Free, to have every kind. Man, we got oldie folks in their 80s here who love Jesus, and their 70s here who love Jesus, and who rock for the Lord. We've got funny looking people in this church. I love it. Lots of funny looking people in this church. We even got some strange looking people in this church. We have people who have it looks like the Shekinah glory, but it's because they don't have any hair on top, and it's a glow. Right, Dennis? I love you, brother. All right. We have my brother. Oh, David, it's so good to see David and Josie from Jerusalem here. David Bivens and his wife. Amen. All right. They got up early so they could make it to church on time here. All the way from Jerusalem. What a blessing, brother. We'll be seeing you soon. Oh, it is really a joy to be able to be pastor here at this church. God has given me, it is a privilege to be able to come up here and look at your sweet faces and know that God is changing so many lives here. Gia's parents, they shared this week, they're going to be starting a ministry here, ministering to other parents who might have children that have gone a little astray. Their daughter got hooked on drugs. Now she's hooked on Jesus. But it's not easy as a parent, is it? It's not easy at all as a parent. My mother had to cry many, many tears over me. My mother had to worry about what was going to be left in the house, if everything was going to be stolen and sold. My mother had to wonder where I was going to be at, locked up at, or if I was going to die because of drug overdose, whatever. My mother had to pick me up, lay in hepatitis-ridden body in a telephone booth, take me to a detox center that didn't work, over and over again. But now the tears she cries can be tears of joy because her son and her family is saved. Jesus is the answer to all of those things. I'm going to have our rap team sing a couple songs, and the first one is called, if I'm not mistaken, Jesus, Jesus, I Need Your Love.
Come on, see you down there.
did that, I saw my Pentecostal brothers and sisters immediately go. Praise God. It's fun to watch a lot of you older folks go. My son is in the bedroom next door to my wife and I. Him and his wife are next door to us. And we got to hear that every night, let me tell you. I think it's so wonderful to our young people to see. Man, I can't say it enough time. I love watching my son and all my other sons and daughters in the Lord, the young people serving Jesus. And that, forget that generation gap stuff, man. I'm telling you. It's awesome, though. Good. Let's do one more song. Rise Up for Jesus. And if you just feel led, you just feel like you've got to stand up and, you know, shake a leg, it's all right. You know, it's all right here to set free. You won't lose your salvation. I mean, your nose won't fall off. It'll be all right. God loved to see his children enjoying the company of other brothers and sisters of the Lord and just having a good time serving Jesus. And I'm telling you, it's important the day we live in because, you know, kids are getting shot and killed every day. Kids are overdosing every day. Kids are leaving home all the time. I don't think any of us want our children to have to go out in that world and suffer. But if we don't make an environment where they can feel at home and enjoy themselves, and if they've got to go to the world to get their happiness, then we're not providing for them. We got to be the ones to do that. Rise up for Jesus.
Jesus Christ, so rise up, rise up, say it with us one time.
right there, brothers. That'll be all right. Let's kick that back one over there. Rise up for Jesus. I know that when the Lord looks on this, he just has a wonderful, wonderful time seeing his children praising Jesus. We need to capture one of our old songs for this video. And this song, we do borrow some of the tunes from the world, and we change the lyrics and get them saved. We lead the lyrics to Christ so they glorify God. But you might remember this song, and it's a song called Start Me Up for Jesus.
Jesus.
Houston. Let me have Tanya up here right now, and Bill and Candace come on up right now, and Lonnie, would you come on up here right now? We're going to have a few testimonies here, and some people share about what Jesus is doing in their lives. The Word of God is the one that challenges you and I to always be ready to give anyone who asks an account of what God is doing in your life. And so when the pastor asks, you give, amen? The Bible says, let the redeemed of the Lord, what? Say so. We become overcomers by the power of the blood of Christ and our testimony. And our testimony as we speak about Jesus. And each of these folks, just going to share for a few minutes what Jesus Christ is doing in their lives. And it's so very, very important that we understand that the Word of God means nothing if there isn't a changed life. You know, talk is what?
Cheap.
Talk's real cheap. Nobody needs to hear any more talking going on about it. They need to see a life that's been changed. You know, life has been changed for everybody in the family, and go, hey, you know what? That person's different. Man, that person was full of hate, now they're full of love. That person was full of misery, now they're full of joy. What's going on? They're not on drugs anymore. There must be a better high. And that's so true. That high is called Jesus Christ. That person, the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. That's why we can sing, start me up, Lord. You got me started where I won't stop. Fill my cup, Lord. Let it run over, man. Because you're the one that made that dead man rise, Jesus. You're the one that made that blind man see, Jesus. You're the one that makes that lame man walk. God hadn't stopped doing those things. He's still touching people's lives today in a special way right now. Bill and your wife, come on up here right now. Bill and Candace right now. And I've never heard a testimony set free that God didn't minister to my heart. Because you see, we can relate with people here. That's why when people come here, I say, hey, don't start fitting in, trying to fit in some mold. And if you're not dressed in a certain way, start dressing like somebody. You be you. Be who you are in Christ. Because if you start out that way, it'll be easy to live your life. But if you start out thinking you put on some funny little outfit and try to dress a certain way, that you're going to fit in, that'll never work. Because the fitting in has to come inside. You have to be accepted inside here. And that's what happened in a lot of churches. People say, you can put a suit on, get a haircut and all stuff, and you know, you'll be different. Oh, that just means you're a washed up pig on the outside. Still a pig unless the heart's been changed. Are you listening? There's somebody here this morning go, honey, did he call me a pig? No, I'm not calling you a pig. I'm saying if you don't have a changed heart, it's just the outside. You know, it's like going to the graveyard over there and getting the tombstone and washing it real nice on the outside. Inside is still what? Dead man's bones. You understand what I'm saying? It's the inside that we've got to make sure the Word of God and prayer is changing lives. That's what it's all about. And growing in the Lord isn't easy. Once you become a Christian, man, it gets tough, man. There's some tough times. But what's the alternative? There's no other alternative. Go back to the world? Uh-uh, we come too far now, baby. We can't go back. Uh-uh, no turning back. We're on our journey. We're almost there. Just around the corner. It won't be long. Bill, Candace.
Praise God. Just as I've heard so many people come up here, the first thing they say, they want to thank God for their salvation, and that's what I want to do. Thank the Lord for my salvation and my beautiful wife that He gave me, that He used to draw me back, because I've been a Christian for many years, and I came to Set Free and got born again. And Pastor Phil, don't worry about the tie. It's made out of leather, so. Basically, I got caught up into serving the Lord in a Christian hard rock band, and, you know, I didn't know it, but I had pride. I was more my own idol than Jesus was my Savior, and I was relying on the foundation made of sand. Jesus, I knew He was there, but I didn't yield my whole life to Him. I was lukewarm, and you know what happens to lukewarm Christians? The Lord spits you out. I got spit out because the Lord told me if I wouldn't change my heart, He'd turn me over to a reprobate mind. I looked that up in the dictionary. It means without conscience, evil. Well, what happened was I went to a party. Thought I was going to be cool rocker for the Lord, you know. Ended up getting involved with crack cocaine, cocaine, and crystal. Did it for a period of about maybe 6 months. And while I was coming here, one Sunday when Set Free was out back, I went in that little bathroom, smoked a rock. That's how reprobate my mind was. Everything was going downhill. My wife had every right to leave me because I did other things against the marriage vows. She has a friend named Carol and her husband Bob, which now are friends. And I'll tell you, the prayers of a Christian brother and sister are really welcome and needed.
Amen.
I came to the point to where I was spending my whole paycheck on all the drugs I could buy. I wouldn't even deposit it in the bank anymore. I'd just cash it because I knew it'd be a waste of time just to go to the Instateller again and get my money out. It got so bad. I got so desperate. I just got fed up with myself. I was in the kitchen just about 2 weeks before Christmas. And I said, Lord, please help me, save me, deliver me from this drug. It had me. I hated it. I would do it, but I didn't like it. I hated it. I said, Lord, I don't want it anymore. Take it away from me. Please help me, God. In the meantime, her parents were over at the house, anointing my clothes, everything with oil. I mean, I'm not gonna tell any mother-in-law jokes ever as long as I live. Her mother-in-law prayed for me, did not give up on me. Just like Pastor Phil said this morning, don't give up on your unsaved husband. Don't give up on your unsaved wife. And the Christians that are living lukewarm, don't give up on God. Well, I had about maybe 60 bucks worth of coke left. I had it on the counter, just rocked it up in the kitchen. Went and took a shower after praying that prayer, you know. Candy was at a Bible study. And took a shower, got out of the shower, said, yeah, I guess I'll just do the last of what I have. It's out there in the kitchen. And that was after I prayed God to release me from this. I was going to go do what I had left. I got to the kitchen. There was a line of ants. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. All the cocaine was gone. If you want to be delivered, ask the Lord. At first I was, oh no, it's gone. Oh. Then I realized, I go, wait a minute. Just a half hour ago I asked God to save me from this. I start crying. I threw my hands up in the air. I was in the kitchen just crying, thanking God for those ants.
Come on.
They came and took away all the cocaine. Sandra shared with me Wednesday. Sandra shared with me a scripture, Proverbs 6. Consider the ant. Take heed to her wisdom. I read that. So that night, that night, 2 weeks before Christmas, I went to bed without going out and buying more. I thought I ought to stick it out. And okay, God made the move. I'm going to, you know, do it. Went to sleep, had a dream. It was the most beautiful dream I ever had. Jesus was over me. He took a sword, a two-edged sword. Cut me open. He reached in with both hands and pulled out this gob of, just looked like tissue. I don't know. It was ugly. It looked like cancer tissue. It was dark and gristly and full of fat and gunk. And he just chucked it. It was gone. And then he just put his hands over me. And I remember in my dream, I looked and there was no stitches, no mark, no nothing. And the Lord said, behold, I have delivered you. I have made you whole. Next morning, I told my wife, I told her, I said, you know what? The Lord delivered me from cocaine. And she goes, I don't believe you. I told her so many times that I was going to get my life right with the Lord. Another thing I told was the pastor. I said, Pastor Phil, I got caught up with a drug. If you guys are doing anything, go to the pastor. Don't hide it. Satan wants you to hide it. We expose the enemy, and he can be shut down.
Amen.
You know, we've got to share. Do not be so full of pride that you're going to just go home and smoke that joint sitting in your room right now after coming here and being blessed by the Lord. I'm telling you, die to yourself, die to pride, die to the old man. So anyways, I tested the Lord. I hadn't been, no desires. He totally delivered me from the drug. Raphael took us out. In the meantime, we went to counseling. The Lord has blessed our lives through the counseling we have here. Raphael and his wife took us out to dinner, and I told him my testimony. And he goes, didn't you have any withdrawals? I go, withdrawals? None. Just no effects, and I was doing so much a day. He said, you should have had withdrawals. Truly, I was delivered by the Lord. And now, and our marriage is better than it's ever been in 11 years. And a church that is a doer of the word. And I'm telling you, this is a call to all married couples. There's no excuse for a healed relationship not to happen. Jesus is stronger than all our sin. It's up to you to hold on and be turned over to a reprobate mind. But it's up to you to give your life to the Lord today, even if you think you are a Christian.
Love you, God. What a beautiful testimony of what God has done in their lives. Never give up. You might think, but you don't know my wife. Yes, we've all got one. They're made out of the same mold. Eve. Well, you don't know my husband. Yes. My wife's got one. Just like Adam. Okay, are you with me? You know, it's either let the Lord give us the strength and the wisdom and the power to overcome, or be a quitter. There's no middle ground. And we can apply that to every area of our life. It's that important. It's not easy sometimes. Sometimes we pray for things and we're just going, Lord, when's it going to happen? And the Lord's teaching us patience. He wants to build strong men and women. And man, there's some rough times that come into our life. There's some hurts that come into our life. But that's what shapes and molds us. And remember, God's going to finish the work that He started. He's going to finish the work. Next brother I'd like to call up has become a very close friend of mine. And we've been able to share and laugh and just have a good time in the Lord. And just be able to, I think, be an encouragement to one to another. And watch God work in a special way. I'd like him to come up and share right now. Brother Lonnie, would you come on up, brother? Amen. Let's give him a big set for you. Yeah. This is Father Lonnie. And we are men of God. And this brother, like I said, is just, I've just laughed and cried and just really enjoyed some sweet fellowship with him. And he's been able to share with me. A lot of you where Christians came out of Calvary Chapels, and one of our elders, Tim Trader, and his wife, our church secretary, Lois, came out of the Jesus People movement and all that. And during the Jesus People movement, I was up at Haight-Ashbury doing the narcotic phony love. But this brother and Chuck Smith are the ones God used to bring what I've heard about, the last revival in the land that's happened here in America that I know about, where I mean a real wave, when you heard about all those hippies and all those people getting saved and all that. And God used Lonnie and Chuck Smith as those two people that died to themselves to God be able to bring that forth. And I believe, I tell you, I honestly believe this with all my heart, that God wants to have another wave, another revival, another touch. But He's looking for some people. He's looking for some people that are not hung up on denominations, looking for some people that are not hung up on outward appearance, looking for some people, man, that say, God, whatever it takes, man, bust me up, break me so I can be used. And that's what we get to share about it. And Lonnie, I know you have some special friends here, man, and I just thank God, brother. Go ahead, share.
Thank you. This morning, I would like, for those of you that know the Lord, to focus for me. Paul says, pray that I might have utterance. So I'm asking that you would pray for me, This morning in my motel room, the Lord woke me up and he said, this morning I'm going to have you speak at Sefri, and this is what I want you to say. And the Lord began to give me revelation. And I believe that it's like what Pastor Phil's saying, that there's an outpouring of God's Spirit upon the land right now. And it says, in the last days, they shall overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimonies. Let's say that. In the last days, they shall overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimonies. Amen. And so you don't want to tarnish that testimony that the Lord has given you. I've been 22 years in the ministry, and this morning the Lord has given me a glorious miracle for you people to know that as you hang on to your testimony, God will do great and glorious things. In the corner of the church, my mother and my father and my brother that's coming out of a satanic cult has come to church for the first time. Circles with big bozos.
Come on.
And I was also overcome by the drug cocaine. And I'm not giving any dates because I'm not stupid. But the Lord has gloriously delivered me from cocaine. You know, it was such an upwardly mobile drug. So acceptable among doctors, dentists, and the clergy. But you see, the Lord's bringing down some things. He's bringing down some things today. So promotion comes not from the east nor from the west.
Come on.
For the Lord raises up one and he puts down another. And that means that you cannot position yourself in God, or you cannot resist the positioning of God when he positions you. You say, not me, I'm bound. I don't want the responsibility. But you know what? Try as you may to resist the voice of God.
Right.
Try as you may to resist the hand of God upon your life, you'll make yourself more miserable.
That's right.
Now, if you'll turn with me to 2 Kings. I'm not going to preach a sermon this morning, but this is the rhema that the Lord gave me when I woke up, and I thought to myself, well, how do I know that that's true? He said, you'll only know when the moment comes, and so now the moment's here.
Amen.
Then Elijah said, chapter 7 of 2 Kings, then Elijah said, listen to the word of the Lord. Thus saith the Lord, tomorrow at this time, a measure of flour shall be sold for a shekel, and 2 measures of barley for a shekel in the gate of Samaria. And the royal officer whose hand the king was leaning answered the man of God, saying, behold, if the Lord should make windows in heaven, should this thing be? And he said, behold, you shall see it. You shall see it be. Then he said, but behold, you shall see it with your own eyes, but you shall not eat of it. Now let me tell you, there are prophets in the land. There are people that represent the word of God. And we're seeing the Lord lift off of some churches and rest down on others. How dare him! You know, where the Lord put on a feast. They invited all the important people to come. And they said, well, you know, I bought a new ox and I have to try it out. And the other one says, I just got married and I'm going to have to bury my father. And, oh, I can't come. So the Lord of that feast got very angry and he said, go out and invite the hippies.
Yeah, come on. Come on.
Said, I don't like your hair. I said, you like it up? And then the Lord went out and invited you guys. And you didn't have any place else to go, so you came. But in that feast, there was one person that didn't have a garment, a right garment, and the Lord said, get out. So the garment that we're to wear at this banquet is the covering of the born-again experience.
Amen.
Though your sins be as crimson, I'll make them white as snow. Though I'll take your stony heart of unbelief and I'll give you a heart of flesh. And he'll do beautiful things like that. But the king of Israel did not believe the prophet of God. He scoffed and he laughed. And so the prophet of God says, you'll see it, but you won't taste of it. So as the story goes along, follow me in your word. Verse 3. Now there were four leprous men at the entrance of the gate. And they said to one another, why do we sit here until we die? If we say we will enter the city, the famine in this city shall, and we shall die there. Okay, now let me explain something. The word of the Lord came to the Jews and said, you have disobeyed me, and I'm going to curse you and judge you for this. And you're going to eat your own babies. And the prophet of God told the people of Israel that they would practice cannibalism on their own offspring. And that is exactly what they were doing. The enemy closed them in round about. All of the food supply were canceled. All of their source of food was canceled out. And they began to eat their babies. And in this day that we're living in, we're seeing sons eating their fathers and fathers eating their sons. But it's a different kind of cannibalism. So the Jews, the people of God, the chosen people of God, were eating each other. And I charge the people of God today, stop eating each other.
That's right.
It says, if you bite and devour and pick on one another, beware lest ye be consumed one of another.
Amen.
And that's happening today. The people of God are consuming one another with a sort of type of cannibalism. Listen to this. If we go into the city, we'll die. Now I would say, if you went into some of the churches, you'd die. Oh no. What a terrible thing to say, Lonnie. I know what I'm talking about. So, if they went that way, they'd die. So they decided to turn and risk to get some food. After all, they were leprous. They were rejected by everybody. If we enter into the city, we will die. Now notice it's the city of God, but it's because of the curses that are coming. I have to quickly move along. Keep me in prayer. Now therefore, let us go over to the camp of the enemy. If they spare us, we shall live. If they kill us, we shall die. They arose at twilight to go into the camp. When they came to the outskirts of the camp, behold, no one was there. For the Lord had caused the army to hear a sound of the chariots and the sound of the horses, even the sound of a great army, so that they said one to another, behold, the king of Israel has hired against the kings of the Hittites to come against us, the kings of the Hittites and the kings of the Egyptians to come upon us. Therefore, they arose and fled into the twilight and left their tents and their horses and their donkeys and even their camp as it was, and they left the whole camp. When these lepers came out of the outskirts of the camp, they entered one tent and they ate and drank Now you can imagine, they were starving. They were leprous. They had disease. Nobody wanted them. They were rejected. Put yourself, imagine yourself to be a leper. And then all of a sudden there's food and drink and clothes and warmth. And then it's like this. Where did they get this guy? They went out to the camp. They entered one tent. They ate and drank. They carried from their silver and gold and clothes. And they went and hid them like a dog burying a bone. Carrying silver and gold and clothes and digging holes and hiding them. So then they went into another tent and carried out from there also, and they went out and hid them. Isn't that base animalistic instincts? Then they said one to another, "We are not doing right. This is a day of good news, but we are keeping silent. If we wait until the morning light, punishment will overtake us." That's the rhema. That is the word. Listen to me read it again. The Lord woke me up this morning with this word. It is a hot word from the throne. Listen. Then they said one to another. They were already dead in their flesh. If we are not doing right, this is a day of good news. But we are keeping silent. If we wait until the morning light, punishment will overtake us. I pray that every single one of you will be sent out of here as evangelists this morning.
Amen.
Do you know that the responsibility could never rest upon your pastor to do this work? Do you know that if you let too much responsibility rest upon that man, that you'll be responsible for his destruction? Rise up, O sons of God, a church for you doth wait, her strength unequal to her task. Rise up and make her great. We're living in an hour where the anointing of God is being poured out upon the people. He said, "I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. And your sons and daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men will dream dreams." Do you know why young men see visions and old men dream dreams? Because if an old man saw a vision, he'd die. So your young men see visions. You say, "Hey, yeah, that's cool." Okay. All day. An old man dreams a dream so he doesn't get too cardiac arrest. And so, you know, people say, "Well, what are you dressed up for?" I said, "I'm dressed up for what I am. And the inside, I am a priest after the order of Melchizedek." And when you're born again, you're brought into the family of God. And let me tell you the plan for this church. You are all ordained as ministers.
Amen.
Now that doesn't mean that you need to go out and have a flip-top wash and wear a priest collar. I'm dressed up to be an example of what God's called me to be, and that's a minister of God. But so are you. All of you are ministers and priests. All of you, the Bible says, to do the work of an evangelist. Now let me tell you, I promised Pastor Phil I would take 5 minutes. But let me tell you, the king of Israel, I'm going to quit now, but the king of Israel mocked the prophet. And he said, "If the windows of heaven could be opened up and he should pour out, it could not even be." But the Lord did it. And you know that king, he stood in the doorway of the city. And when the people found out there was food, they trampled the king of Israel to death. He saw it, but he didn't get to taste it. So many ministers today, they're laughing at the prophets of God. And they're saying, "Oh, nah. No, We stand in all the promises of God and in this dusty old church. Everything's going to be done just as it was. And if the rapture of the church would take place, churches would still continue on just exactly as if nothing happened. See, now, so the preachers are up saying, God can do this. God can do that. They're not really moving in faith. They're not really moving in power. And they're going to get trampled in the gates of the city. And they're going to be trampled by the people. And the people are you. Now, listen to that word again. This is from a hymn from the Reformation. Listen to the words. Rise up, O sons of God. The church for you doth wait. Her strength unequal to her task. Rise up and make her great. Thank you very much.
Amen. Rise up, O Church of God. I hope you were listening with your spiritual ears, because God is visiting his people. We are his people. God is here visiting us this morning in a special way. The hand of God is here. I was with Lonnie and Dennis, and we went to the Vineyard Friday night to hear a prophet speak. And there I was talking to people, sharing with them, and I'm taking down this lady's number and sharing with her. I'm going to pray for her son. I'm going to try to go visit him. And Lonnie looked over and goes, you're getting more work, huh, Phil? You haven't got enough work. I can't shut my mouth when it comes to someone having a need. I can't. It's not me. It's the Holy Spirit blowing on me, and I'm consumed to serve God. I don't want to do it. I'm just like everybody else. I would like to just go hang out and do what my flesh likes to do. But the Holy Spirit's blowing on the life of Phil Aguilar, and I can't stop it. And there's a place full of people here. You can't stop witnessing to your mom. You can't stop at your work witnessing, and you know it's causing trouble there. People go, hey, you got to cool it around here. You're stirring it up around here. Let the Holy Spirit blow. Try to resist it like Lisa. Try to resist it, and you'll be most miserable. You can't go on. Let me tell you. Every one of you are a believer priest. That's so important for you to know. You have authority in Christ to go out and witness, to go out and pray for people, to go out and love people, to go out and minister to people. God's here this morning. If your heart's open, you'll be able to experience what we're talking about. And you might be saying, you mean God would even use me? Yeah, don't let the name fool you. Prophet, apostle. Apostle means a sent one. I was listening to this prophet the other night, and he said it was the greatest message he ever had in the world, and he was telling people's names in the audience, and he didn't know he was doing wonderful little feats like that that excited everybody. But at the same time, he says, this wonderful message, he lost his notes and couldn't find them. You see, we're regular folks, but we got a spectacular Holy Spirit that lives within us, who will bring down the strongholds, who will minister to those lepers in our society. Are you afraid to touch people? Talked to a sister the other day here, praise God. She found out her new job is working with AIDS patients. I said, praise Jesus! I've been praying that some people are trying to get an open door to minister to them. To minister to them? Yeah, we want to reach out to every kind of folk under God's sun, because we know that's God's heart. God's heart. Looking for those that nobody else wants. That's right. But it's going to take every one of us. Baby, I'm just a little piece of this along with you. It's going to take all of us working together. It's going to not take us criticizing any place or anything else. It's going to take us saying, hey, set free as a family together, serving God. Let's do our part, man. Let's do our part. Let's not devour and bite one another, but let's esteem one another higher, like the Word says. We are members of one another. We are our brother's keeper. We are to love and encourage each other in the Lord, to forgive each other. 70 times 7, over and over and over again. We keep on doing that, man. What a visitation of God will have here, what we can see the Lord allow us to do and to be privileged to do. Let us let revival really begin here today. Let's let a new wave of God's Holy Spirit come over each and every one of us. Let's toss away all the things we think are important and let us see what God really thinks is important. Let's not waste time putting down anybody but lifting up Jesus. And I'll tell you, you'll see wonderful things happen in your life. I want to call this next young girl up. Tanya, come on up right now. She loves Jesus.
I'm 18 years old, and I'm just going to tell my testimony, because we are overcomers by the blood of the Lamb, the word of our testimony. And I used to be scared to get up and tell my testimony. I say, I don't want to talk about the past. It's the past. I don't even want to talk about it. I want to leave it behind. I want to ignore it. I don't want any part of it. But you know, we are overcomers, and we got to share with everybody. And I want to share with you what God's done to me in my life is a miracle that I'm here today, and probably everybody else too. When I was 12 years old, I was an alcoholic on hard alcohol, and I was hooked on speed, and I OD'd on drugs at the age of 12. By the time I was 16, I was hooked on cocaine, lived at a drug house, and it wasn't fun. But you know, it was better for me there than it was at home. Because at home, I stayed up every night till 4 in the morning waiting for my alcoholic mother to get home because I was scared, alone. And I would stay home from school, miss school at the age of 10 to watch my 4-year-old brother because my mom never came home for weeks. And you know, Jesus was there with me all my life. He was there. He was there. And whenever we feel alone, he's right there with us. I mean, when I was 15 years old, I was partying under a bridge. And we were just partying under a bridge and slept under there. And all this graffiti's all over it. And right above it all, it says, Jesus Christ is Lord. And these big red letters. And I mean, woo! God was there. He was there. And I mean, he had to throw me into the Denny. And I was thrown into the Denny and slammed in there. And I was in there for a while. And it was... nobody wanted me. My mom didn't want me. Nobody wanted me. And it doesn't feel good when you don't. You are not wanted and you're not needed. And I just got really beat up before I got in there. And I was, the doctors couldn't come see me. And I was just in a lot of pain. And finally, in the middle of the night, I was just praying because there's these people that came into the juvenile hall and they said, are you going to go to heaven or hell? And I knew Jesus when I was a little kid. But I mean, they're going, are you gonna go to heaven and hell? And that, I mean, I was crying, I was in pain. No doctors could come, they wouldn't see me. And I was just, God, if I die tonight, I pray I'll go to hell. And I mean, I OD'd on drugs 5 times before that and almost died. But I didn't care, I wanted to die. I was very suicidal out there in the world. But when I was in that Denny and I was sober, and I felt death, and I was scared, and I'm all, God, if I die tonight, take me to heaven. And right then, 5 minutes later, at 12:30 at night, a lady walks in just to check on me. Thank God. I was burning up. I was sick. She called my mom. My mom would not come get me. They had to get the cops to make my mom come get me. She wouldn't even take me to the hospital. She took, assigned me over to another person, gave me away. In the time, she tried giving me away and away. And you know, it doesn't feel good when you're not wanted, when you're not loved. And you know, I love you guys. I know I'm needed. I know every one of you guys, every one of you are needed for the body of Christ. And don't let the devil lie to you. Rebuke that liar. He's the king of liars. You rebuke him. Just be bold in the spirit. And pray without ceasing. But God's done a mighty work in my life. And I got out of that Denny, and my aunt called me on the phone. I was in there, and she's telling me how Paul was in jail, and don't worry about it, God's with you, and just tell me the word. And I felt so good. And I mean, I went out there, and I got better, and they prayed for my leg. They thought they were going to take it off all infections from this fever and gross stuff and stuff. But anyways, God healed me, and he's done mighty stuff, and he's healed me from the past. Still hurts, it kills. But you know, I used to hate my mom with a rage. And now it's like I love her so much and I'm praying for her. And came here and the Lord just drew me here by his spirit. I mean, not by mind, not by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord, and his spirit just moves. And everybody just be free and let his spirit move and let him use you, because I'm so glad I'm here. I love you guys.
Yeah.
It's not scary up here. You guys are all my brothers and sisters. And just keep growing in the Lord. I know that God's going to do mighty things amongst us. He says in Jeremiah 33:3, call upon me and I will show you great and mighty things which thou knowest not. God showed me great and mighty things. And it's awesome, I love it. And I don't know what else to say. It's just, I'm so glad I'm up here. I wanted to tell you so much, but it's just, I love you guys. And just keep growing, okay?
All right, Tanya, thank you. Yes. Yes, she does love Jesus. That young girl lives in my house, and I'm telling you, she's like that all the time, man. Her and Kathy Shinhofen and a few of them all, yeah, Jesus! Oh, man. Old ladies fire up our line. You know, when she was sharing, it reminds me, I started a pastor's fellowship last month with a group of pastors, and I've got a number of other pastors all joining up this month for our group. And it's a bunch of preachers getting together just to encourage each other, pray, share with each other. But these preachers, you know, they come talking to me, and, you know, they kind of act like they're supposed to act if you're a preacher, a real tough man of God. But then they go over to our secretary, Lois, and they go sniveling and whine, a lot of them. I won't name their names, but a lot of whiners in the body of Christ. A lot of crybabies in the body of Christ. A lot of snivelers. Oh, woe is me, I'm in the ministry, it's so hard. Well, get out then, you bum. You know? This girl, 18 years old, she's had a few tough times in her young life, wouldn't you say? But I'm telling you, I don't hear her whining at home every day. I hear her speaking the word of God. I hear her rebuking the evil one. I hear her encouraging others. She's an example to me in my home. I am excited to be able to be blessed to open up my home to have somebody come in and minister to me, 18 years old. I'm glad to see a 19-year-old son of mine, as I listen to the words of those songs they write about Jesus, lifting up Jesus. A whole lot of wimpy Christians because of, I've got some tough times, or I didn't get this, or I didn't get this motorcycle, or I didn't get this car, or I don't got this job. What a bunch of wimps. The shoe fits, put that baby on. If it don't, say amen.
Amen.
Come on. We're talking about God building soldiers. We're talking about people who want to rise up and take that neighborhood, take that job place. Take that place where you hang out for Jesus. We're talking about having one cause. Apostle Paul says, but this one thing I do. He couldn't be good at everything. He couldn't be doing everything. Well, only one thing. If your thing is making sure your house is the most beautiful house in town, then that's your thing. But baby, I'm not giving my life to my house being the most beautiful place in town. There's other things on my mind. That's seeing young children. Teenagers come to know the Lord Jesus Christ. That's seeing people that are in their 70s and 80s on the doorstep of hell, saving them before they go into the fire. I'm telling you, it's important. But we can't, none of us can do it alone. We need each and every one. Man, we need, I'm telling you, I need all of you to pray for me. I need all of you to work together with me as we work together to serve the Lord Jesus Christ. There's a warfare going on. There's a battle going on. And all of us are to do the work of an evangelist, to go out and win people to Christ. All of us are to disciple someone, make disciples. Share what you know with someone else. The older women, the Bible says, they're supposed to help the younger women. Older women, the Lord, you're not helping younger women. You're not being obedient to the word of God. You're supposed to help the younger women to grow and teach them how to be keepers of home and be obedient to their husbands. Hello. Get kind of quiet. Whole lot of heavy stuff in that word of God. There's a lot of people today love getting their ears tickled. A preacher coming up and talking about all these neat things. And a whole lot of people, all they want to spend their Christian life is talking about, I wonder if he speaks in tongues or not. Yeah, you know, that's a nice gift. It's a gift from God. The Bible says, forbid not to speak in tongues. But you know what? That is one of those gifts of God that he gives to people, and they could share, and everybody might think they're spiritual. But you know, another gift is the gift of hospitality. Who do you have over your house lately? Who have you been inviting over? That's a gift. Or the gift of giving. What have you given to somebody? No, I don't mean emptying out your garage, get it cleaned out, and give it away. The old junk you don't want. I mean something you like. I mean something dear to you. Something that hurts to give. That's what giving's all about. That's what the gift of giving's all about. And a whole lot of people don't go on a big rampage. Man, we gotta give. Because that makes the flesh die. But all of us woke up this morning in Christ to die to self. We're all called to be martyrs, to die to the flesh. And the flesh don't want to die, let me tell you. Does it? Flesh don't want to die. You don't want to be inconvenienced. But we love hearing special words from the Lord. Or, I saw this vision, or I heard that, or this felt that way. We like those type of things. But as soon as we leave this place, we're going to deal with the realities of life. A wife, children, somebody we work for that we don't necessarily like. And like Tanya said, at 18, has she got any reason to hate her mother? If you're going to hate somebody, got a few reasons. But does she? No, she got to die to the flesh. Say, I love my mom. You know why she loves her mom? Because Jesus lives in her, and Jesus says, you're going to love your mom. You've got no right to hate your mom. Because I'm going to turn my back on you, young girl. You're going to love your mom. But I can't. And we can't do it on our own. But with Christ, you know what? We can love everybody and anybody. I stay here on Sundays after church for hours. On Thursday nights, I stay here for hours because God has told me you stay there. And anybody needs to talk to you, you talk to. Anybody that needs ministry, you do. And that means anybody. God does not want us to be a respecter of persons. When you reach out, you enlarge your heart. You'll see people drawn to Jesus. You see people drawn to Jesus. I've shared this before. I said, you see that person standing on the corner looking up. And if he stands there long enough, what will other people do? They'll come and go, I wonder what he's looking at. I wonder what she's looking at. That's how people are. They're curious. The way you win your families to Christ is you start looking up to Jesus. They're going to be calling you and say, what are you looking at? Come here. Don't be looking up there. There's nothing there. Just in love, tell them to shut up and leave you alone. You're going to keep on looking up to Jesus. And you're going to keep following him. You're going to keep serving him. Come on, there's a family reunion. There's a party. There's a... Shut up and love. You keep on serving Jesus. You keep on looking for people who want to hear that message. And finally, they're going to get smart. Because God has promised that if you live for him, you'll serve him. If you delight yourself in him, he'll give you the desires of your heart. And that's for our whole family to get saved, for our boss to get saved, for our neighbor to get saved, for our friends to get saved. And that's what's happening around Set Free. There's no great eloquent speaker that comes here to speak. There's a guy named Phil that stumbles over his words. There's a bunch of regular folk that come up here. But there's a group of people in here that are so excited about Jesus. You had to tell your neighbor to come today. You had to take mom. You got to take this joy now, man. You got to come over here. It's changing my life. It's you. You are the ministry. God is using each and every one of us. God is pouring out his spirit upon all flesh. And upon this place right now, we have the opportunity to take one big giant step of faith. Say, okay, God, today I'm going to step out. God, I'm going to receive everything that was here this morning. I'm not going to try to sort it. I'm going to receive it and say, Lord, this is for me. This day was for me, Lord. Because you know what? How I feel right now? This service was just for Phil Aguilar. He needed it. He needed the minister too, from these testimonies, from all those that shared, from those that did songs. God's changing hearts. He's changing lives. Don't miss out on it. Let's all stand right now. Sing, Lord, thou art a shield about me.
You're the lifter.
Service. Those of you that maybe watched it on TV or something last night heard there was a fellow that not much of the world knew, a guy named Buster. And he fought this guy that most of the world knows, a guy named Iron Mike Tyson. And I'm sharing with you, God can make the top, the bottom, and the bottom, the top at any time he chooses. And I've had a lot of Pastor Phil, you can't be a preacher and not wear a tie. Oh, is that right? Well, I'll try to wing it as best as I can. You can't play that Christian rock and roll, no? Gee, it's building us up in Jesus, and our families are happy. You know, God's doing his thing in people's lives, and he's having his way, and some folks might not like it, but we all got to learn that everybody is answerable to God. And we're not to judge another man's servant. A lot of people, a lot of churches worship the Lord in different ways and praise God. Don't try to change some other church's doctrine. Try to change your opinion about how you look on them. And realize that God's not finished with any of us yet. And let's let him make us and mold us to what he wants us to be. This church has its own personality God's raising up. We have young and old, big and small, funny and not so funny. Strange and weird. And everything goes in between all that. God's doing the work. Sure, when Mike Tyson went in that ring last night, he didn't think things were going to climb and end up that way. And I kind of liked it. Here, everybody wants to fight the guys so they can make the big bucks. George Foreman's going to have to get a job now. Going to have to get a job now. Oh, you shouldn't pick on George Foreman. No? I'm encouraging George Foreman. I'm encouraging him when he gets on a program anywhere, they interview him, talk about Jesus. Don't talk about making the bucks. I'm encouraging all of us, and myself, when we have an opportunity to share, don't miss it. Somebody asks you, how's it going? Say, this must be my opportunity. Your boss goes, how you doing? That's what Pastor Phil's talking about. I'm doing fine. Jesus is in control of my life. How are you? Take every opportunity from the Lord. We got our first opening, Elaine, this week to go to Lincoln School. They haven't let us in any schools anywhere because they know we're not going to tell them some motivational, powerful message. We're going to share with them, say no to drugs and say yes to Jesus. We're not going there for any other reason. Saturday, Friday after we went to the Vineyard Prophet thing over there, we got done, we went out to go minister. We drove an hour and a half to get to the city of Sylmar. At 11 o'clock at night we arrived. It had been a long day. Many things happened. But the Holy Ghost says, go! Lord, I'm tired, man. I'd love to go rest. He says, get in the stinking van. Didn't say quite like that, but something like that. Get in the stinking van, load up a bunch of brothers, and go. A friend I shared with you Thursday night, his 16-year-old son got shot and killed. they were having his awake, and 300 young people gave their lives to Jesus. 300 young people. The mom and the dad loved Jesus, but their 16-year-old son got killed last week. That happens to Christians. The rain falls on the just and the unjust. 16-year-old son. What would you feel like if somebody shot your child? I'll tell you, it'd be a lot of hurt, wouldn't it? A lot of pain. Possibly some thoughts of revenge. I'm going to go out and get them. Possibly thoughts of blaming God. Everything could run through your mind because the devil would love to whisper all the little things in your mind. See, look at God. He didn't take care of you. He doesn't love you. But this man shared that he believed that God saved his son, spared him, and took him before he got deeper involved in those gangs, before he broke more hearts, before he did more destruction in other people's lives, before his testimony was ruined anymore, because he was a Christian fellow. But God took him home. He said, son, sorry, but I'm taking you home because I can see you're not living right. I'm going to take you home and save you and save your family from a new life of misery. And I was there with the dad. And that night they did it. Guess what they're doing around town? The other gang that shot his kid. His name was Sonny. They're writing F. Sonny. What would you do? What would you think? Wouldn't that break your heart? Is it enough you kill my son, but rub it in my face? Called dying to flesh, coming on the scene again. You know, you just kind of die again to flesh. No quick trips. You can't got some formula for Christianity. If I pay money and go to this conference, I'll come out of there all right. Baloney! I ask every person I met that other night at that conference, what are you doing for Jesus? What's going on in your life? Well, here I am, and go, come on. I go, man, Christians, the Word of God teaches that afflictions will come our way. I looked up afflictions. I looked up endurance. There's no shortcut in this Christian life. This man's kid was killed, and they rubbed it in his face. But they didn't stop there. They started riding by the house, saying, F son of your son, who's dead. Took it a step farther. You know, that's heavy. When they come there to the house, say, we killed your son. Ha, ha, ha. But every time one of us is silent about sharing Jesus, that's what we're doing. Every time we're silent, we're afraid to share Jesus because of some situation, we're scared to share the Lord, we're making his death on that cross nothing. Worthless. We're copying out. And we give a lot of good excuses. Well, I don't want to share because I don't want to, you know, make anybody offended. No, we're to speak the truth in love, but we're to speak it everywhere we go. You know what the family was doing? And they had all the friends over there, and they had ex-Mexican mafia guys, and they're all Christians. Now, you know what this whole family's doing the other night when all this is going on? They're in there praying. They're giving God the glory, man. They are not stopping, and they have just begun to get excited about Jesus now. Sometimes it takes the death of someone like that. Unless a grain of wheat falls into the ground and dies, then there can't be any harvest. God, allow our lives to be broken in a special way, not by situations like that that have to happen. We have a choice. The Bible says that we would judge our lives and look at our lives, examine them, say, hey, Lord, you know what? I'm going to get rid of this, and I'm going to just let you take over. God says he'll make a deal with us like that. But he says that we won't get our lives right. We won't get our lives right. He says, baby, it's to the woodshed. Off to the woodshed he will take us. Tyson made some funny comments about people he fought before. There's a sissy in there, man. He cried for his mama. Well, that boy was crying for his mama on the deck last night. He was eating dirt last night. All I'm saying, I like the Tyson. I'm praying for him. I'm going to send him to the ranch when he gets here. You know what I'm talking about? The guy he fought just got saved. He just got saved. Somebody is going to say here, he got saved. I heard what they said in the interview. I heard what he said in the interview.
Yeah, I kicked his ass, man.
What do you expect a baby Christian to talk like? Some of you so holy you forgot when you got saved. You bite your dirty mouth. But some of you say, well, I never had a dirty mouth. Well, some of you are still dealing with a heavy pride problem then. You know, the guy don't know anything else. He's a baby Christian. But we can build him up by praying for him. Build him up by praying for him. That's what it's all about. Winning people to Christ and then building them up in the Lord. I'm glad that you came here this morning. This isn't your regular run-of-the-mill place. It's a dangerous place to be if you're not saved. We have our bikers or ushers in case anybody tries to leave. We've been accused of making people get saved, but only Jesus saves you. Only Jesus. It's your choice. Nobody can force you to follow Christ. But if you'd like to give your life to Jesus and you've never done that, or if you've never done that publicly, I invite you right now to come and stand right up here. And we're going to have some prayer for you if you'd like to give your life to Jesus. If you're not 100% sure, if you die today, you go to be with you, come on forward right now. Anybody like that? Maybe you brought somebody, you know they don't know Jesus. Walk forward with them. Give them some encouragement. That's it. You come on right now. If you'd like to give your life to Jesus, come on up. We're going to pray with you right now. That's it. Praise the Lord. Amen. Get off, Bonnie. All right. Praise the Lord, brother. Yeah. Come on right now. All of you that love these people, if you come minister, come and surround them. That's it. Yeah. Bring them up. You got somebody that needs to get saved near you? Bring them on up right now. We're going to have some prayer. Anybody else? Just bring them up right now. As you're coming, let's sing Hosanna again, okay? Anybody that needs to get saved, you need to give your life to Jesus, get on up here. Don't be ashamed. That's it. Come on forward all the way to the front. Yeah, praise the Lord. That's it. Bring them on up. Come on. Yeah. Sing it to the Lord and be in prayer. Come on up to the front, yeah. To Jesus today.
right here. Saw bowing heads right now, and I want somebody from our church to be with everybody up here. And everybody, give us some opportunity. Let's have some prayer time together here. Everybody here, making sure you're with somebody. Heavenly Father, those that have come forward here right now, Lord, to make decisions, God, give them the boldness and strength to speak these words. If you want to receive Christ, just repeat after me, but express as a desire of your heart. Lord Jesus, I come to you a sinner. I come to you broken. Jesus Christ, I believe you died on the cross for me. Come into my heart, Jesus, and take over my life. I want to live for you. From this day forward, I don't want to turn my back on you anymore. Help me to read your word. Help me to be with other Christians. Thank you, Jesus, for saving me today. Heavenly Father, you have saved these people that have meant it from the bottom of their heart. The Holy Spirit right now, I pray, would come and seal this decision that's been made. Holy Spirit, do your work right now in their lives. Don't let the evil one near right now, that this seed might be planted deep and this decision, these commitments might be mighty and strong. Heavenly Father, as brothers and sisters, we gather around our new members of our family. God, may we do our work to encourage them, to be with them in their times of needs, to pray with them, to be the older brothers and sisters in this family. Heavenly Father, I thank you for all those that have given their life to Christ today, Lord. I thank you for all those that are here today, Lord, that have made new commitments to take another big step of faith. Heavenly Father, oh, what an awesome God you are. You're so good to us, your children. You've given us new family members. You've given us new strength today. You've given us new hope, Lord, today. Thank you, God, for speaking to us. There's so many here this morning. Thank you, God, especially for all those that you've saved here. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. We're going to dismiss this morning to the song, We're All a Family, gathered to worship the Lord. And make sure that you talk to people and share, and you don't have to leave for as long as you want. We're all a family. Let's sing it to the Lord.